Hello, and welcome to Wyverns and Weirdos: The Journey Home. I'm your Dungeon Master, Darby, and joining us, as always, are Zoe, playing Sevia, Emily, playing Beatrice, Laura, playing Conrad, Johanna, playing Fall. Let's jump into it. Where we last left off, the party were in combat, taking on the memory of the day that Yinagu and many of his demons attacked the village of Idleness, the home of one Beatrice. So we just had Mordenkainen. Was first on the initiative, last to go in the last episode, and he used a wish to heal everyone before. That's right, he was down, I think. All right, so, but he is still concentrating on that fly spell. So Sevia, you and he still have a fly speed. So next in the initiative is Fall.
Right, yeah, so Fall had just seen that his many, many wounds had healed. He looks over to Conrad to check if he's okay, who Conrad was in quite a bad state. Then realizes that it was Mordenkainen that did this, and he was like, Mordenkainen, I guess you're not always that bad. And now, Fall is going to make the most of this opportunity to rush at Yinagu and to a flurry of blows.
All right. Now, so your speed is
45. I can just reach him.
Yeah, literally just. Yeah.
Yes.
All
excellent.
Right.
So that's a 23 to hit.
23 on Yinagu. Yes, that hits.
Fantastic. So do a blow with the staff of striking. That's 11 damage, and I'm going to do two charges. Additional damage. So that's an extra 9 damage on top of that.
All right, so 20 damage all up.
Yes. Brilliant.
And that's force damage, isn't it?
Yes.
Yes.
Bludgeoning
from the staff itself and then force from the charge.
Yes, that's correct, yes. Okay, and now he's going to go in for a kick. And that is 19 to hit.
At 19 just misses, unfortunately.
Yeah, very high AC.
Yeah.
Okay, another blow with the staff. That's a 22 to hit.
22 will hit.
Awesome.
So you're just whacking away at his ankle here, basically.
Yes, I'm just going at his ankle, essentially. So that was 11 damage. I'm going to do another two charges.
All right.
That's another 7 damage then.
That's 18 damage total.
All
right.
And then a final blow, a final just kick to the ankle. Isn't it 20?
Okay.
So I get, unfortunately, not that banana. That is 2d6 plus 5, so 12, 17 damage plus my roll, which is 15.
So 32.
Excellent. Fantastic.
Yinagu is shaky, guys.
Fantastic. Yes, I just wail on him. And then I'm going to use the extra 10 feet of movement that I get to, while staying within his range, to just kind of go in between Sevia and Beatrice.
All right.
So, like, are you guys all right as well?
So 10 feet of movement?
Yeah.
So get
just over there.
Kind of here from where you were. All right.
Awesome. That's my go.
All right. So next in initiative order is Beatrice.
Beatrice.
With Conrad on deck.
Is, I am fine. It's all good. And she, seeing that Unigo is a little bit shaky, she's going to bonus action Slayer's Prey on him and then take a swat at him. 27 to hit.
27 will certainly hit.
And because Fall is there...
Yes, you do get sneak attack.
Sneak attack. So I need those. I need those. Not the biggest roll I've ever done. But that's... 24 points of damage.
24, okay.
Of radiant damage.
All right. That unfortunately doesn't modify the damage type or the damage amount at all, but it's still a solid 24 damage.
And then she goes again. 24 to hit.
That will hit.
Very good to hit on this one. And so that's 12 points.
All right.
Damage.
All right, and that's the end of your turn?
It is indeed.
At the end of your turn, I believe Yinigu's still got two legendary actions left this round. He might have all three, but what I need is reliant on two. He's going to use his Savage legendary action and make a bite attack against every creature within 10 feet of him. So that's everyone except for Conrad and Mordenkainen. So let's start. That's a 26 against you four. A 27 against Beatrice. A 31 against Sevier.
Are you kidding me?
I rolled a 15. He has a plus 16 to hit.
At least it's not a 20, I guess.
And then a dirty 20 against the Brock. So Fall, you take 10 points of damage.
Oh, good. It's not too bad.
Beatrice, you take 14. This is all piercing damage, but I don't believe anyone has resistance. Sorry, CB, you take 18.
At that, I'm going to do a sentinel attack.
All right. Roll to hit.
So now swing at his ankle. That is a 24 to hit.
24 will certainly hit.
Fantastic.
And the Brock also takes 18.
So he takes 14 damage.
14 damage, okay. Mm-hmm. Alright. So next is Conrad.
Alright, so Conrad would have, like, woken up with a revive of a start. Momentarily with no breath, and then breath as basically the wish just forces him back into life. He nearly died. He just, like, wakes up, just looks around dazed at, like, the blood all around him, because I would still be there. He just has blood back again now.
And there's a weird sensation of, like, you're probably feeling the most yourself you have in quite a while.
Things are both very, very loud in his head and very, very quiet. And he just kind of just, he's just still just keeps shaking his head as he's trying to just, like, clear whatever is going on. So he's going to use half of his movement to get up.
Yep.
And then I'm going to bonus action dash to get into melee range with our friend.
So,
because Conroe doesn't learn. I presume he'd be able to get there, or would he be able to get there with like his dash and his half movement?
So with the bonus action dash and then your half movement, that gets you to 45.
All right.
And you still get your action left.
I'm going to try and stab with my rapier.
Yeah, roll to hit.
I'm just going to really quickly double check to see if it would still have flames on it. Bonus action. Do you drop or sheath it? So would I have dropped my... I probably would have dropped my sword then.
You probably would have.
Yeah. So it does, I don't have the bonus fire. That's all right.
Yeah.
Either way, that's some damage. So it's a 27 to hit, so that
27 certainly hits.
Yep. So
and you
D8.
Do get sneak attack because
There
are lots of folks around.
Heck yeah. So 6 plus a 7, so 13 points of damage plus my sneak attack, which is... Hang on, that's my d6. 6, so 8, and what's that? And 10 additional points of sneak attack damage.
All right. So piercing. Total of 23 for your first hit, I believe.
Second hit. Is a 20. I don't know if that hits.
Just hits. That's basically exactly.
Okay, cool. So d8. Another 6, so 13 points of damage. And then I don't get sneak attack for that one. So that's the end of his turn.
Alright. It is the Vrock's go. The Vrock, I can't remember whether it's... I don't think it still has its... currently has its spores. It doesn't get it back either way. It's gonna use its stunning screech. So can I get everyone, because everyone's within 20 feet of it, to roll me a constitution saving throw. Yinagu doesn't have to because he is a demon and is therefore immune to this.
This is music to his ears.
Mordenkainen is too far away to be affected by the brunt of this.
I got a 19.
19. That is a success.
I got a 4.
4. Okay, that is a failure. Thevia?
11.
That is a failure. Beatrice?
15.
15. That is a success. So, Thevia and Fall, the two of you are stunned. Beatrice and Conrad, you're fine. There is a shrieking in your ears. But you're able to kind of block
the noise
it out
is back again.
something like that. Alright, then is Yinagu's turn, which means that he gets all of his legendary actions back. But he can't use it until the end of someone else's turn. So Yinagu is going to multi-attack. Three flails. So the first flail will be against... Who do I want to be against? I am gonna... Because Yinagu is demon, force of chaos, gonna roll a d4. Got Conrad, Fall, Beatrice, Sevia. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3 is Beatrice. You're going to take the first flail attack, which is a 25 to hit. And he's going to add... What effect is he going to also try to add to this? Okay, roll me a constitution saving throw, as you also take 21 points of bludgeoning damage.
That's a 22.
22, that is a success, so you are not paralyzed.
Sorry, how much damage was it?
21 points of bludgeoning damage.
Cool.
All right. Second attack is going to go to... that is Conray.
Okay.
That is a 20... A dirty 20 to hit.
That hits. 19 is Conrad's AC.
Okay.
Not really enough. He's still just completely dazed.
Is this going to be... need to re-roll that. I'm trying to... Okay, there we go. This is going to be the one that does the extra bludgeoning damage. That's already 21 plus 14. So a grand total of 35 points of bludgeoning damage.
Alright, 35. Alright.
Yes.
So he again gets knocked for 6.
Yeah.
Alrighty.
That's a third of your hit points in one flail smash.
He doesn't learn.
And the third attack will go to... That is a 4 on the d4. I am so sorry, Sevia. This is... I will roll in case it is a nat 1.
The dice have decided. But, it's fine.
If it wasn't an auto crit, it would have crit anyway.
Did you nat 20?
I did.
Hit me. Let's go.
Just out of curiosity, I'm gonna... Okay, so either way, it would have been 30 plus. You're also gonna have to make me a wisdom saving throw for this.
Wisdom, okay. Yes.
You should be good at this. Okay, I rolled low on the damage.
Natural 20 on my wisdom
okay,
save.
Okay, so you are not confused.
Nat 20
you are
off.
Just in. You are not confused, you are just... you are just stunned and in a lot of pain.
How many points of pain, Darby?
So, 23 points of bludgeoning damage. Because I only rolled a 20. 2 on the dice. Yeah, I only rolled a 2 on the dice, plus the 9, so that's 11, plus the 12. So 23. I believe that still gets you below half your hit points between that and the other attack you've taken. Yeah. Squishy wizards.
Squish.
And it is your turn, although I don't think there's much you can do because you are stunned.
Yes, there was a question. So I can't move, which means I can't get up. And I can speak falteringly.
Yes.
But I have a question.
And you automatically fail strength and dex saves. And attack rolls against you have advantage.
She basically already fails those.
Yeah.
Okay, this is going to be a little bit of a Hail Mary, because I both don't think it's going to work, and I also think he's going to save, but just a quick little question. Is Yanogu an undead? He's king of the undead. No?
No, he's not king of the undead.
I thought he was a prince of...
He is a demon lord, not an undead lord, a demon lord.
I think he should count as an undead. He's in hell. Okay, cool.
Also, because you're incapacitated, you can't take actions or reactions, so...
I can only do bonus actions? No.
Actually, I guess technically you can. Like, it doesn't say anything about incapacitated creatures not being able to take bonus actions.
No,
those are technically actions, but technically it doesn't say you can't.
Yeah. You just can't move and you can speak only falteringly.
Okay.
So you would be very restricted on what bonus actions you could take.
Considering I only have one actual bonus action spell.
Is it something that requires somatic components?
Yep, so I can't do
it. So you can't even do it?
Nope.
Unfortunately.
It would have been cool if I could have, but that's fine.
I'm sorry, but at the end of your turn, Yinagu's gonna use his savage again. Like, you've got him on the ropes. On everyone. That's how savage works. So he's gonna make a bite attack against everyone. So Conrad first.
Fair.
That is a... Oh, just because of the rotation here.
Yeah, awesome.
That's a 23 to hit.
That hits.
But low damage, 11 points of piercing damage as his teeth gnash into you.
He's not having a time of it.
Second attack is... Were you stunned No, who was stunned? It was Fall and Sevier, wasn't it? That's it. So Fall. So this is going to have advantage, and as long as it hits, it's an auto crit. Which it does. So it is high damage.
Hit me.
28 points of piercing damage.
Okay.
Beatrice, this one actually is, well, again, like that's 20, which is above your AC. So that is 15 points. And finally, Sevier again, just like Fall, advantage as long as it. And again, redundant natural 20. My Beyond Dice apparently. My Beyond Dice apparently hate you tonight. So that is for a total of 25 points of damage.
Just a quick question. Because Fall and I have now taken damage, do we get to save against being stunned?
No. Not with this particular stun effect.
Cool.
There is an end state to it. There is an end state. But yeah. Mordenkainen, because of his weakened state, is just going to bolt back up into the air. And he's gonna launch a firebolt at Unigoo, because he can't really do all that much else without causing harm to himself at the moment. So that is natural one. Yikes. Okay, yep. Literally the only roll I could have made but would have missed.
Look, as long as he doesn't accidentally just shoot one of us instead, I am happy with this. He can rest for the 6 seconds.
Alright, let's. Unigoo is kind of desperate at this point. So he's going to do a swat away attack with his last legendary action for this round against Fall. Fall is stunned, so...
Beatrice.
So that is a 28 to hit, and max damage 21. All right, Fall, your go. You are stunned. I don't believe there is anything you can do unless there is a bonus action that is. Well, you've got technically healing word. I think is verbal only and bardic inspiration.
Oh, so I can do verbal only?
Technically could.
Okay. I think Fall is just going to kind of just like be like, just like start shaking and look very stunned and out of it and just kind of like looking between a Unigo and the Vrock. But then kind of like fixes his eyes on probably Sevier and then is going to say, hang in there, everyone. And I'm going to cast Mass Healing Word, which does not heal a lot.
No.
At all. But everyone will take 6 health.
Just double checking that
like
is...
up to 6 people.
Just double
it's
checking
just
that
verbal.
Is purely verbal? Okay.
Yeah. It's a bonus action verbal.
All right.
So, yeah, everyone that's taken damage... take 6 healing.
Alright. Um, I forgot to do this at the top of the round, but at the top of... at the top of the next round, the cackling demon lord shuts his maw and narrows his eyes, gazing up towards the sky as a beam of radiant light pierces the haze. A powerful angel streaks down from above, followed by a gold-furred mammoth with feathered wings. The angel slashes her sword across Yinegu's chest and utters a spell. A portal opens behind the demon lord as the mammoth rams its head into Yinegu. Demon lord is sent tumbling back through the portal, which quickly closes behind him. Right. There is still the matter of the Vrock, though, so...
And I believe it's Beatrice's turn.
Yes.
So Beatrice is going to turn around and look at the Vrock and be like, "There, time for you to piss off." And is going to take a couple of swipes at him. So first one is...
You won't get sneak attack because Sevier is incapacitated at the moment.
26 to hit.
That will certainly hit. Okay.
And that's 12 points of damage.
12 points. It is still up, but incredibly shaky.
24 to hit.
24 will certainly hit.
And that's another 10 points of damage.
All right. And that is enough to have the Vrock explode out with Ica. Can I get a constitution saving throw from Fall, Beatrice, and Sevier?
21.
21's fine.
20. Dirty 20.
20 is fine. Sevier?
I thought it was a bad roll, but then I checked my thing. 17?
That is by far, like, successful.
Phew.
DC's only 10 for this. Yeah.
I don't want leg arms.
The odds of you getting leg arms were slim. There are many, many effects.
But never zero.
We still in initiative?
We are not.
Okay.
So.
Are Sevier and I still stunned?
No. No. The stun effect was about to end on the Vrock's turn. And Zariel lands and turns to where's she going? She's gonna turn to you, Beatrice, and say, "Olanthius, secure the perimeters."
What?
The perimeters, we don't know if there's more coming. There might be the dregs of what have followed Yinegu here.
Beatrice nods and says, "All right, we'll do." And we'll, but before running off, we'll bend over and cast Cure Wounds on Sevier. If I can find my spells. There it is. She's going to cast it at... She's going to use her last second level slot. And see if it gets... 15 points of healing. Is that me? Yeah, that was me. Was that me?
So 15 points. Okay.
Yes.
Let's hope that that was the last of them.
I'll say, what is the meaning of this? Get us out of here right now. Quite strides off angrily towards Zariel.
Yes, yes, I mean, thank you very much for taking out that thing, but can we leave now?
Harriman? Vanus? What is this obstinance? You have sworn duties as Hell Riders to protect these people from the infernal and fiendish hordes.
I did no such thing. What are you talking about? That's not my name. What's going on here?
Harriman, have you been possessed by some sort of demonic insanity?
Excuse me.
Beatrice calling back over her shoulder is like, we are not ourselves. We are part of illusion. That's part of what we are doing here. Conrad, she thinks we're other people. She thinks we're part of her crew.
You know? Yes, I see. Great. Good fight there. You were very helpful, Miss Zariel. We will do this. Yes, absolutely.
Like heel turns and like under his breath, with a faulty assurance, like, oh, I didn't realize I'd sign up for a fucking play.
Yes, absolutely. So we have to try to be in character for these people?
When does it finish? We haven't even been given a time.
No, I mean, I'd hope by now we'd pass the test.
It is one.
Must be.
That's just where we are now.
Oh, I really hope not.
You see, in reaction to Beatrice's words there, you see something kind of click in Zariel's eyes. It's like, this is... And she looks momentarily at you, Sevia. Is this your doing, Gale? Well, I guess you wouldn't know, would you? You're not really Yale.
I may not be Yale. Unfortunately, for otherwise I would be able to tell myself off for this one. But yes, this is Yale's doing.
Can you tell me why? Why have you been sent here in this illusion, as your friend says, of this day? What is the nature of this illusion? What is its purpose? If this is an illusion, or your presence here is illusory in nature?
Well, you do raise the conundrum of if we have actually been time-traveled and this is all an illusion projected onto a real day, then this might create quite the time paradox. We were sent here to see the day Idleness was saved. As there will come a time in the future when Idleness is destroyed.
And there is a look of pain on her face at the prospect of this village being destroyed. And she places a hand on your shoulder and uses, she's gonna do this on everyone at adventure. Beatrice still being off in the perimeter, she's not gonna use it on quite yet, but she's got enough to use this once on everyone. When they're nearby, she's going to use her healing touch ability at this point on you, Sevier, to heal you for 46 points of damage.
46?
Yes.
I'm back up to full.
Yeah. So that is 8d8 plus 4.
Yikes.
And freed from any curse, disease, poison, blindness, or deafness. If Wish had already done all that.
Mega Paladin.
Hmm. Yes.
Thank you.
Of course. How fares Yael? If this is indeed her doing.
Sevier appears to be considering her words very carefully on the off chance this is a sort of paradoxical illusion. And not a full illusion. I believe in the wake of what happened in the destruction of Idlenest, she has become a sort of shadow of her former self.
That is a shame. She was one of our brightest. She is one of our brightest.
She is still very bright. She is the one who sent us here. With no warning, I may add, as a fellow, categorically smart person, it does pay to have a few people skills, tell people what they're in for. But she seems clever.
She is. I will be sure to pass on the message, and whether it will impact her at all in your time, I have no idea. Why this day?
See, Idlenest is Idlenest's say to see the saving of Idlenest. We are looking to avenge it. One of our number called it home for many years until it was taken. This is part of us deciding how to enact that retribution.
How was it that the village was taken? I will stand watch, I will stand guard, and I vow that I will never let it fall.
A betrayer, a fallen angel, dragged it to hell. Person by person, piece by piece. Murdering anyone who stood in the way. And they will take you as well, Zariel. I am sorry to say, but if we are in fact in a paradox, that does not mean there is anything we can do to prevent this outcome. And if this is a full illusion, and once Yael calls us back, then as noble as your willingness to stand guard is, it is hollow. You will also be betrayed by the person who dragged this city down.
So, I have a question about that particular phraseology.
Yes.
Do you mean that in that, like, she has betrayed herself, or are you saying that she will be betrayed by the person who took down this city in order to obfuscate the truth?
6 of 1, half a dozen of the other. She doesn't want to tell Zariel.
In this scenario, it is not. It is not.
She fully means that seeing what Zariel did to save this city, which is fly in at the last minute on a mammoth and punch a demon in the face, and hearing what Zariel has said, she would feel betrayed by her own actions.
Okay. Because the reason the distinction is important in this particular case is that with the Solar stat block, She has an ability called Divine Awareness, and she knows if she hears a lie.
Ah, I am not lying.
No, and that is why I needed to ask.
Yes.
Does she carry her sword with her?
She does, but she has now sheathed it.
Okay. Azariel, if I may speak, although this future is a terrible one, I think there are ways that you could help. You could help us to, I suppose, bring back order in a way. To whom exactly would you... We are in possession of your blade in a way, and we believe that there is some kind of qualities needed for you to bequeath it to any of us. What exactly do you think this would be? Through this, you could help restore this village.
Who was it who fell?
That... I'm sorry, but that is not of the most importance. We need the blade. Details, you know.
Conrad, finishes kind of just checking the perimeter, the inner perimeter. He's just keeping an eye to see. Beatrice might be on her way back by this point. I'm not sure. But noticing Falk kind of was like, in our present time, we have had a saying that your sword could be both your downfall and your saviour. Is there truth to this? What would it mean? If it were.
It was me that fell, wasn't it?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. And I see that the idea of that hurts you.
It pains me more than I have ever been pained.
So then would you be able to assist us in understanding, would this sword vanquish you? Would it release you from having fallen?
It can do either. It has a power to it. It has a cleansing nature to it. If I have been separated from the blade, then it is entirely possible that it could... return me to my celestial form.
I see. Thank you very much. And there was also there was a saying with the blade that the hero who becomes one with this blade exists no longer. Do you have any insight on that?
The sword has a way of directing the wielder. Not controlling, but directing towards the action that is good and right. Suggests to me that I was separated from it at some point. And she offered, like, proffers her hand out towards your shoulder, Fall, to, with a, like, a light magic that you see that's similar to when she cast Healing Touch on Sevier.
Ah, nice. Yes, thank you.
Okay, so you regain 39 hit points.
As she does this, Sevier's gonna, like, look over at Conrad and just kind of, she has a weird little look on her face, and she's mostly just looking at him, and then she turns back to Zariel and she goes, Zariel, may I ask you a question?
Of course.
I know this is a lot. You have just discovered that you will be the reason this place falls.
Yes.
On the day of your saving of it. Do you think the version of you that does this would want to be redeemed?
I do not believe that that is my choice to make.
It is a choice to consider. Will you, Zariel, if we bring you back, be able to live with what you have done?
I cannot know for certain. But what I do know is that should I be brought back, I will spend the rest of eternity atoning for what I have done.
Thank you.
Through all of this, Beatrice didn't actually go to check the perimeters. Beatrice sort of walked as far around a corner as she could, but within earshot, and wrapped her cloak, nature's mantle, around herself and sort of hid, because she herself can't talk to Zariel. She can't make herself do that.
So where were you hidden? She wanted. Because that may be important.
So she would have walked... So where Conrad is, she would have walked up, and if you go sort of northwards, no, other way, up.
Yep.
Around. This is very hard.
This is.
No, back towards yourself. Okay. So where one of those is sort of hanging off the side, she would have ducked up.
Okay.
Ducked up there, probably a little further back than that, yeah. But that's roughly where she would have been.
All right. Okay. Yeah, because if it was just the cloak, she does have true sight.
Yeah. No. And I did roll stealth. If you were wondering, I have to pull up my...
What horrible score was it?
That's a very good question. Would have been 26 all stealth,
right. Yuck.
She briefly offers her hand out to Conrad for a healing touch.
He keeps just periodically just shaking his head a bit. He holds his hand out.
Yeah, she gently touches it to heal you for 39 points of damage, which I believe that technically doesn't put you up to full health.
It doesn't.
No, you're off by one.
Got a lot of blood caked all over him.
Yeah.
And when she does it, it's like, Petrel, your sword.
Yes.
You're a bladeswoman.
I am.
So you know the qualities it possesses.
I do.
If it were used to redeem you, what would happen? How would you do it if there was someone else in that same position? Do you think it's capable of doing that?
I think it is capable. But I know not how it would be done.
It requires more finesse. And I believe you are some otherworldly being. An angel?
That is true. I am High Angel of the Celestials.
It requires something even greater than that. Interesting.
I would suspect that if I were to wield it, then its good would be enough to take hold. And if I am wrong, then the sword will simply refuse to be wielded.
I see. So it is a matter of hypothetically, of course, depending on if we have truly in the past or not. It is a matter of making you want to wield it. Yes? And be categorically good enough for it, shall we say?
That would be my suspicion, yes.
I appreciate this. You're taking this wound rather in your stride. Which, regardless of being a figment of our imaginations or a real person, is quite good, honestly.
Beatrice comes back at this point. And
Kurt, like, looks over at her and just, like, tries to wipe off more crusted blood off his face.
As Beatrice walks up, she pulls a chain out from underneath her clothes that she plays around with and then lets it drop, just sitting on the outside of her clothes. And on the chain are two rings. And she just walks up and stares at Zariel.
I apologize for what to you I have done, to me what I will do. And you would be well within your rights to slay me where I stand. And not to offer me any chance of redemption. I would not blame you.
There may have been a time where I would have most definitely taken you up on the offer. But this meeting has perhaps given me a little hope. And Beatrice just looks back down.
There is a flickering to you. I feel whatever enchantment brings you or your consciousness here is slipping. If I recall this, I will attempt to keep it in mind for as long as I can. If not, then let me impart you with one final gift. And I say one final gift. She technically does two things. One is use her final healing touch on you, Beatrice.
Beatrice puts her hand out.
For 34 points of healing. And she, where is this? So she gives you all there is a question here. Tell me before you go. Would you risk everything to save others?
I would.
She looks at you, Sevier.
Yes, I would.
At you four?
Yes, I suppose so. I mean, I have, I guess.
And Conrad?
I already have.
Now, does Conrad perceive that to be the truth?
He does.
Okay. So you all gain as you bind the illusion dissipating around you, a charm, the charm of vitality, which is a supernatural gift within the, so the charm of vitality allows you to give yourself the benefit of a potion of vitality as an action. Once you do so, the charm vanishes from you. So potion of vitality removes any exhaustion you are suffering from and cures any diseases or poison affecting you. And for the next 24 hours, you regain the maximum number of hit points for any hit die you spend. I hope to see you again. Good luck.
That much is inevitable. See you soon.
And you find yourselves back in the temple.
Is the spirit lady there?
She is.
Yes, Yale there.
Was the vision enlightening?
Is that all you have to say to us?
You are under no real harm.
I mean, it was very painful.
Sevier, throws her hands in the air.
Under no real harm. Of course, I suppose it wasn't, probably wasn't real. Kara goes for a little walk around. Just again shaking his head.
Well, it was most interesting.
You have faced many trials to claim the Sword of Zariel. I'm sorry to say you face one more. As the inscription on the dais says, the hero who becomes one with this blade exists no longer. Which of you is brave enough to draw the blade and be gone forever?
Oh. Okay, Yael, look, I'm really going to need some clarity because Zariel actually said something different. She said that basically the sword kind of guides you towards doing the good thing, which, you know, if I was good at swords, I would be very willing to do that. But you're making it sound very much like we're about, like, you know, one of us grabs onto the sword and, you know, like that old legend of, you know, the man with the sword and the rock. And then we just, you know, poof, out of existence and we're replaced by a little angel with a flaming stick. Yes,
I could have captured that better myself, Celia.
I just would like some clarity as to whether or not you mean a metaphorical loss of oneself.
Yes, it is a metaphor. To lose oneself to the mantle of hero. Sacrifice all selflessness and take up arms against what is wrong and fight for what is right.
Well,
you know what? This is exactly the kind of disagreement that I had with, like, the people and the monks of Kirteth. Do you really need to be wholly selfless to be good? I mean, that's what they do with a lot of philosophy and such, but, like, a lot of people that are like that are actually kind of bastards. And self-preservation is a really good thing, actually. Or you're just going to immediately die for the next person who's in trouble. Anyway,
I understand that, and as I understand, the blade understands that. There is no heroism in throwing yourself in harm's way for the sake of throwing yourself in harm's way. If what you are doing is truly selfless, then you must be able to continue it. There is no sense in sacrificing yourself if that sacrifice is going to lead to the downfall of others. Those who need you, those who you and they make each other better.
While she says that, while Cora's just pacing, he looks at Sevia, and he tries to catch Sevia's eye, and then just looks up at the sky. And then his eyes kind of settle on the earring that she's wearing, and then he continues to pace while she's talking about sacrificing yourself needlessly.
Sevia, like, has been so, like, just And when Conrad does that, her face just drops. And then she, like, pulls some of the hair that's, like, hanging in front of her ears, like, tries to cover the earring. And then she's going to look around and she's going to look at Beatrice. What's Beatrice looking like hearing all of this? I will insight check if she's hard to read, but...
Beatrice is looking... contemplative. She's definitely thinking very hard.
Stevie is going to go over to her and she's going to lean in and just say very quietly to Beatrice, regardless of the outcome, is this a mantle you wish to bear? Or is this one you want one of us to hold for you?
I do not think it is anyone of yours burden to bear. And Beatrice looks up and steps forward. I will try.
And you place your hand upon the hilt and lift, and the blade easily comes out of the stone. You can choose to attune to it immediately. Which has some has a couple of repercussions.
Sheely tune immediately.
Okay. So the first time you attune to the sword, you are transformed into a heavenly, idealized version of yourself, blessed with otherworldly beauty and a touch of heaven in your heart. Neither magic nor divine intervention can reverse this transformation. It does say your alignment becomes lawful good and you gain the following traits, but we're going to ignore the alignment thing. But you will get the following traits. So you will have... I will have to double check what of this is from the sword itself and what is part of this transformation. But you have resistance to necrotic and radiant damage while attuned, at least. Your charisma score becomes 20. You sprout a beautiful pair of feathered wings that grant you a flying speed of 90 feet and the ability to hover. Your eyes become luminous pools of silver, and you can see in normal and magical darkness. See invisible creatures and objects, automatically detect visual illusions, and succeed on saving throws against them. Perceive the original form of a shape changer or a creature that is transformed by magic, and see into the ethereal plane, all within a range of 60 feet. We're gonna ignore. Well, there are personality traits that you can take on if you would like. But I will leave that up to you if you would like to take that on.
Yeah, that might be a in between. Yes. Sessions.
And then there are other things that the blade has. Some of them I have to work out because there's a random properties thing, because this is an artifact. You all witness this transformation of Beatrice. Beatrice, describe to us this idealized version of yourself.
Oh dear. I saw that. She grows a little taller, a few inches. One of the main things is her whole sort of, she's usually quite hunched and sort of very tight in on herself, and she just sort of straightens up. Probably all of the white feathers she's got turn to a sleek blue black, and she just looks that little bit younger and a little bit lighter in herself. And the wings that would have sprouted would be just that perfect sort of blue black sheen.
Okay. So, as you all witness this transformation, the citadel around you explodes outward in blinding rays of light. And there is damage here, but that's for creatures that are outside of the citadel. Any fiends nearby take a shit ton of radiant damage and are hurled 1,000 feet away from the sword. And Yael's ghost bid you farewell. I wish you luck before Sol fades away and passes into the afterlife, her work being complete. And that's where we're going to end it for this episode. And that's where we're going to level up to 13.
Ooh! Congratulations! Dun, dun, dun. Slightly younger, hotter Beatrice.
Oh.
What an episode!
That's wild.
Oh my god.
Have a wonderful week, everyone.
Yes. See you next week, everybody.
See you next week.
See ya.
Goodbye.